Welcome to real-world boot-up sequences. My name is Sim Hobson. I'm going to kick this off. There'll be two other guys after me talking about our experiences with Spring Boot in the real world. I'm a developer at Intuit in San Francisco. I have a sordid history of using frameworks to get work done. If you've used good frameworks in the past, you kind of get used to not reinventing the wheel, and I'm not a fan of reinventing wheels. And if you've used good frameworks, you also know that you can actually move fast and have good architecture, even with a kind of a big framework. So a little bit about the product we're working on. It's called QuickBooks Self-Employed. It's a financial management compliance tool for the self-employed. We just launched this spring. Constantly putting out new functionality. So a little bit of context. About a year ago, we decided to actually start building this product, but we didn't know exactly what it was going to be. From the technical standpoint, you want to make sure that whatever you choose from a technology standpoint is quite adaptable, because we knew that we were going to be pivoting quite a bit. We had no customers because we had no product, but aspirations for millions. And so another consideration was scalability and extensibility. And finally, we had zero lines of code, which is both awesome and scary. If you've worked on legacy systems, it's no fun, but we got to start the legacy. And so when you start the new legacy, you kind of want to put it on the right footing. And so one of the things we wanted to do is establish good patterns early. And we had an aggressive timeline. We really wanted to get this thing out to market quickly. And as a result, another consideration was the developer productivity and operations productivity. And it turned out that our team was doing both. So we can call it DevOps productivity. And then I'm an old timer, and I've been through a few large projects. And I had a kind of a laundry list of things that I needed, that I knew we would have to support. So, I mean, you go from Hello World to prime time, you're going to end up needing pretty much, you know, everything in this word cloud and more. So again, in the technology considerations, we had to choose something that could handle all this stuff, such needs. So Spring was a prime candidate. I mean, obviously the Spring framework is vast and does everything. People on my team, including myself, had done Spring in the past and in the bad old days, and it wasn't something that we thought we could just kind of pick up and go with and move quickly. But then, you know, Boot started to come out of the woodwork and was promoting itself as the simple path to Spring. And so, you know, we thought, interesting, because it has everything we want. We decided to kind of give it a shot. So this was the question we were asked to talk about. You know, tell us about your experience with Spring Boot. I have to admit, I was totally intrigued by this whole no XML, no web XML promise. That was the hook for me. So we started prototyping early days, 0.5. Spring Boot. So clearly new, raw, found bugs as we were going along. We worked with the Hello Worlds, and we kind of mashed them up together into kind of a kitchen sink. As we're going through that word cloud of all the things we needed to have working, found bugs, but you know, it's open source, so you can download it, you can debug through it. Sometimes we just couldn't understand what was going on, and so we actually engaged with the Spring team, and they were all over Stack Overflow, the issues in GitHub. Really fast turnaround for a question. I mean, you'd ask a question the next morning, it'd be answered. If you submitted a bug, they would have a fix in within, it seemed like hours. It seems like they were just waiting. So that was awesome. And then, you know, we kept seeing things get better and better. We started taking out more and more of our hacks and workarounds. But it wasn't you know, without its problems. So we had some growing pains, one of which was we needed to deploy as a war. And if you've heard all the talks about boot, it's kind of geared towards jar-based deployment. And that was kind of a side thought, I think, initially. But we pushed on it, and you know, the bugs were fixed, the configuration issues were fixed. We initially wanted to give Mobile BaaS Spring a shot, based on some experience that we'd had in the team with Mobile BaaS, and it just would not wire up properly. And so we kind of had to abandon that and just use JPA with Hibernate, which, by the way, works great, not a problem. And the other thing, when you get started with these new, like if you've worked in Spring before and then you kind of move to boot, you kind of need to understand this magic. And so we did have to kind of debug through, see what the behavior was behind the scenes to see, like, why was it choosing certain things? And so you learn about all the conditionals that are in place. You know, conditional on beans, conditional on properties, conditional on things being in the class path and things like that. And you understand that, you start to understand how the decision process making, you know, is happening. And then once you understand that, then you have to decide, okay, Spring Boot is deciding to configure my system a certain way. Should I override it or not? I mean, every app is unique, every situation is unique, but you know, and so there's a, you do have to make a decision about whether you're going to defy the convention. Spring Boot is trying to make a best effort to do the right thing, but it may not be the right thing for your app. So that's one of the things you have to look at. Security is where I spent the bulk of my time, and it's not Boot's fault, but it was just one of those things where every enterprise has its own internal security stuff you have to wire up to, and Spring Security is infinitely extensible and customizable, but as a result, you know, we had to do quite a lot of work. And Spring Boot tries to do, again, a best effort of trying to wire up the right security stuff, and you know, we had a web app, and so again, you have to decide what are you going to defy, and what are you going to roll your own with. And this is when we were doing prototyping, we were able to get WebSockets working in a matter of, you know, minutes, and it was awesome because WebSockets solves a lot of our use cases from the user's perspective, and it worked great on our machines. But when we threw it out into the data center with all the routers and Apache servers, it just was not reliable, and so that was kind of a letdown. But again, it's not Boot's fault. That was kind of our data center spot. So nonetheless, I mean, we eventually stabilized, decided to go for it. It worked. We've been in production since May. You can actually go to selfemployedintuit.com, check it out. We roll out features every few weeks. We deploy multiple times a day. We just released our mobile companion apps, which leverage the same back-end infrastructure. And you know, we, in a sense, we couldn't be happier. So I'll just quickly go over some of the things that I think kind of made it all work, despite kind of a rough start and you know, eventual success. A lot of it is sample apps. I mean, we started with those sample apps. That's kind of what got us going and made us start to believe. The documentation was initially kind of like an afterthought, but then it became serious and it became as thorough and as the rest of the Spring documentation. This is really one of the key things. I think that despite the fact that Boot was new to the world, it was kind of front and center on Spring.io, as you may have noticed. And even before the GA release, it was kind of like the big thing. You know, people like Josh kind of just wouldn't stop talking about it, and you could tell that they really wanted to make this work. Source code, I mean, I've got it on my machine here. You can build it, you can run all the tests. It's not rocket science, and it's really nice when you're trying to learn kind of what's going on behind the scenes. And you know, if you look at the number of committers in the GitHub project for Spring Boot, you know, it's dozens upon dozens. It's not just the core Spring committers. It's a lot of people. Probably people at this conference, because when we would find bugs, we would either just say, "Hey, here's the problem," or we would do, we just, you know, propose a poll, and they would take it, right? And that was cool. It made you kind of feel involved. They actively solicited pull requests and feature requests. In the end, we don't have one XML file in our system, which made me really happy. I don't know. I don't know if it's because I've suffered through the XML file hell, but it's just it made us kind of feel good that we were able to do that as promised. One of the other things that boot does is it, because it's trying to manage your whole like POM craziness and dependencies, your POMs become very simplified because you just depend on some of these starter POMs, and it just allows you to kind of worry about the non-Spring things in your POM, which is also kind of nice. We've seen immense developer productivity. We still shake our head, like every day, it's like, wow, this is so easy. And that's one of the reasons we can kind of keep cranking out new features. So, you know, the framework is not in the way. The configuration is not in the way. You know, it's time, basically. magic is nice. I mean, the fact that this just kind of all works is both, it's scary, but it's also cool. But I think the longer it works, the scariness kind of goes away, and now you just kind of expect that the magic works. And I've just, of all the frameworks I've used, this is the one that I would take with me if I was to kind of do my own thing. I mean, I've worked on a lot of stuff that, you know, for the enterprise that you kind of have to work with, but this is one of those things that I'd take out the door with me. It's just so productive. We use the better part of the Spring framework. Pretty much every annotation you can think of. We use the YAML configuration and profiles along with other things. Use the better part of the web support. And we also have a batch process, including crash. But again, it's the enable auto configuration that kind of allows all this magic to happen. So turn it on and let the magic happen. Now we did have to do some overrides and some configuration changes. We do data migration, we do customize our entity manager and the JPA factory. Our batch process runs as a system process, basically, and it runs for weeks on end. And we just use add scheduled to run jobs. And we can SSH into the batch process and run Groovy commands to just execute things ad hoc, which is kind of neat. Like I said, security is one of those things we had to put a lot of effort into customizing because we had a very unique scenario. And so that's one of those things where, thanks boot, but we're going to do our own thing here. So that there was a fair amount of work on that side. On the website, we just, we did some minor customizations to the container. We intercept browsers that we don't support. Just some old IE versions don't necessarily work. And we did integrate, since it was an Angular front end, we did integrate some of the JavaScript CSS builds as part of the Maven build. Not rocket science again, but it was just something we had to do. And the part of the actuator thing that gives you the kind of the Git properties, we use that to do our static asset versioning, to do cache busting, which was really useful. Yeah, actuator. So if you haven't used it, check it out. We locked it down with admin rights. We wrote our own custom health indicators. We wrote our own UI actually for the admin, which leverages the APIs of actuator to some degree, and then also has some custom stuff that we use for customer support. We have Splunk in our data center, and so we did lots of logging, leveraging logback. The Angular client has a little trick in it where if there's any errors in the JavaScript, it actually sends that server side. And so if there's problems, we can actually kind of see the user experience end to end, which is really useful. And even more useful, actually, is if we have problem users, we can actually turn on debug logging for their session. And we do that from our admin console. Very useful for that problem customer who just can't get anything to work. And then we kind of implemented, you might have heard of Spring Session. We've kind of done something similar where we have our session in Memcache so that we can do rolling deployments. We just take down a server and it stays up. And finally, testing. Enable auto configuration is just as applicable to your tests. So, and it's actually a good way to learn what you need to override and what you need to kind of let go of. Because if you just say enable auto configuration and you don't leverage profiles or you don't do anything, you're just going to have a real like production running system. So it's one of those things where you learn, okay, well, I want to use profiles. I want to have you know, specific overrides for the test profile, for example, like using an embedded database and things like that and mocks. We use TestNG and mock MVC, and it all works great. And it's so much easier to kind of bootstrap your unit and test system tests. So that's a big deal for us. Down the road, when we get some more time, I do want to kind of look into Reactor. We do some async processing, callables and whatnot, but I'd kind of like to use a standard pattern for that. We're going to get into inter-process messaging as we get into more collaborative work or collaborative features in our product. You know, I talked about the Maven, you know, the POM simplification. Well, Spring IO is actually promising to be the bomb about making that even simpler. And I'd like to get rid of my own Spring session implementation and use the one that's coming out this fall. That's about it. I'm going to give more time for these guys to get up here and do their thing. If you've got any questions, we'll be here right after for about 30 minutes, hopefully. So hold your questions. You can find me basically on HoserDude pretty much everywhere.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining us today. I will be talking about my experiences with Spring Boot and Spring Data and other projects. Can you hear me? No? Okay. Oh, I see. That's better now. Okay. Today, I will be talking about my experiences with Spring Boot and other Spring projects, how I used these projects in my professional life and how I could basically benefit from it. The title of my presentation is Porting Legacy Apps to Spring Boot in 1 Week. I'll be telling you the story of one of my projects. My name is Erdem Gunay, and I'm working as an expert software developer at Turkcell. Just a few words on Turkcell, where I'm working. Turkcell is a mobile telecom operator operating in 9 different countries and having 71 million subscribers. That makes it the second biggest operator in Europe. In our R&D department, there are around 400 developers. Most of them use Spring Framework for implementing their software, like for 8 or 9 years already. So we use heavily Spring Framework. Just a few more words on Turkcell. It started as a GSM company 20 years ago. Then it became a communication company with mobile and fiber broadband capabilities. And recently, trying to converge to a technology company providing cloud-based cloud computing solutions, M2M solutions, mobile finance education solutions to our individual and corporate customers. How I met Spring Boot. It was last year in San Francisco. I attended Java 1 conference. There I met Josh Long. I don't know if you joined his session at 10:30. Who joined Josh Long? Okay. So he had a quite similar performance there in Java 1 as well. And the session I liked most at Java 1 was Spring Update session by Josh Long, and there I heard basically about Spring Boot, what it can do, how you could use. And then the chance came to me with one of our mobile applications. This is our mobile video application that runs on Android, iOS, and mobile Windows mobile phones clients. What it does basically is a local video platform where the users can search local actual things going on in Turkey. The content are retrieved, downloaded from 4 different providers, and we put them all together in our application. Like you see the categories on the left. When you click on a category, you see the list of videos according to the search or category. And then if you click on one of the videos, it should be playing the video. But the backend was implemented by a vendor company. I had to take the responsibility of the code because of some reasons. When I took the responsibility of the code, it wasn't in a good shape. We had some difficulties because of the way they decided to implement. They didn't use any Java EE container like Tomcat or JT or another thing, or they didn't use Apache Web Service. Instead, they tried to build a system based on JBoss Netty. So they implemented all these things like web server, RESTful API, everything themselves. This is a REST class. I don't know if you can see it, but this is how you expose a RESTful web service to your clients. So it wasn't very easy to manage it, to maintain it. And also in the business logic wise, there were some code repetitions making life even more difficult for me to manage, to add some new features on it, and unnecessary repetitions. This could be simplified. And you see how we had to expose a RESTful GET service. Can you imagine writing all these codes yourself? So what I have done is basically, I decided to rewrite everything from the beginning, from scratch, keeping the business logic, of course, because I didn't have the chance to impact any change on mobile clients. My first principle was no client update. So what I have done, I decided to do everything, rewrite everything in Spring Boot, using new Spring 4 capabilities like Spring Data, Spring Security, everything with the new things. And I started with the 15-minute guide at spring.io.
Can you just switch the microphone over to the other side?
OK. It's good now. Shall I repeat? OK. I started with a 15-minute.
I'll just do it here.
Bye. No? Still not?
Good
now? OK. I started with a 15-minute guide from spring.io platform. If you have visited, there are plenty of guides, really, really cool guides, very short, easy to understand, easy to follow, and easy to apply. So that helped me start with the Spring Boot. And at the end of the first hour, I had a beautiful application with a very simple, RESTful API in it, Hello World API in it. So what you have to do, what you get basically after this, you get a very simple Maven POM file, like Tim also stated. Before Spring Boot, it was you know, most of you probably have it. It was very difficult to manage the versions of dependencies. You could get conflicts. But with this one, all you have to do is just define your parent POM as being Spring Boot's starter parent and the modules that you want to use. If you want to expose a RESTful web service, all you have to do is just include Spring Boot starter web and actuator. Then comes the application. That simple. One line of real source code and few annotations in your application with the main method. So you can easily run your web application as a Java application from Eclipse or IntelliJ, whatever is your favorite IDE. It's that simple. In order to expose a RESTful web service, all you have to do is define a controller, do the mapping, and then do your expose, methods, web methods. That simple. This was the first hour. It was a quick start for me to have something running, to build the new things on top. In the project, we use MongoDB to store the video metadata information, the tags, categories, labels, descriptions, what it is all about. So in order to be able to use MongoDB in the project, all I had to do is just include another dependency, Spring Boot starter data MongoDB, and one line of configuration to state where MongoDB resides. These two things are enough to use Mongo capabilities in your project. That was so quick. I mean, and what I like about Spring Data, not only Spring Data MongoDB, what I love about Spring Data is the repositories. Anybody using repositories, Spring Data repositories? Yeah. It's really amazing how simple the things are now. Before, I didn't like data manipulation at all. We had to write some interfaces, data access object interfaces, implementations, write Hibernate code or some other things, whatever it was. But still, we had to write some code. With the repositories, that's over. No more implementation, no more code. And in the morning, I attended Greg's session. He said a very, very good word. No code, no bug. So it's faster and it's bug-free. So this made the things even easier. Together with Spring Boot, what I love about this is Spring Data. And it's a quite good abstraction over data storage systems. You don't have anything in this interface. You do not have anything bound to MongoDB. You can use easily this interface with a JPA and a relational database system. So I strongly recommend you to give it a try. Spring Data is good. Having these simple things, you can now fetch the data, do your CRUD operations, whatever you want to do in your controller class, controller beans, service beans. Just you can auto-wire any of them. You can auto-wire a Mongo client if you want to do row-level operations. You can include Mongo operations, Spring Data MongoDB's kind of template bean, or you can directly use your repository to do operations. Again, the same day, the first day, I'm still on the first day, the other thing I had to configure was Elasticsearch. We use heavily Elasticsearch in order to index video metadata so that we can easily find them. We can easily return the search requests. All I have to do is include dependency and do Java configuration. Tim said that they had a principle with no XML. We had the same thing. We do not have web XML. We do not have any XML configuration file. Everything is quite easy and simple with Java configuration. All you have to do is annotate your bean creation method with @bean annotation and do the rest, whatever is necessary. Here it's just Elasticsearch specific few lines of code, basically two lines of code. And then, like Mongo operations, Mongo client, I can use Elasticsearch client anywhere I want to use, I need to use by auto-wiring it. So the first day went like this, configuring the project with the other dependencies. Now I had everything, and I had to migrate the business logic without impacting the client side to the new project. All the REST, the legacy REST APIs are migrated to @REST controllers, REST controller beans. Architecture is redesigned, code repetitions were removed, and then it became a true, simple Spring 4 web application. I re-implemented it as a Spring 4 web application without any XML files. Zero mobile client updates. I didn't produce any impact on the clients, so we didn't have to submit anything on the markets like Apple or Android market. Thanks to these Spring Boot and Spring Data components, it went quite fast. The development was faster because I could only concentrate on the business logic, how to manage, how to redesign and rewrite the business logic. So it was faster development. Running and debugging has never been so fast to me because I didn't need to package my application. I didn't need to deploy it on a separate Tomcat or another container. And for debugging, I didn't need to bind them together. All I was doing is run as Java application or debug as Java application. So it was quite time consuming for me. And then we also had to manage this JBoss netty thing. but it was very simple. Apache Tomcat 7 was already there, embedded by default, used by Spring Boot. And for streaming, we had to stream the videos to mobile clients. Tomcat didn't do it. I tried, and I saw that Tomcat cannot do streaming, any download, partial downloads, but we could easily use Apache web server. So these two together were enough. I didn't spend any effort on replacing the legacy web server thing. So what we get is basically simple REST controllers, auto-wired all the necessary beans, like video search service, video repository for fetching the data and persisting the data, Elasticsearch client, everything easily. And then our RESTful web methods became normal, standard Spring RESTful methods. And what we gained. Just by replacing the backend with a robust, working, not crashing version, without any impact, any client on the client side, any change on the client side, we gained 5 times more users visiting our application now. This, the blue line you can see there is the day when I put the new application, new backend in production. The day after, it starts increasing, the number of sessions, the number of users coming in, watching videos. Since then, it's been like 7 months already, it was in February. Since then, we do not have a single crash in terms of users not being able to play any video. All the video requests are processed perfectly. There's not a single crash on backend. So it's in a quite good shape now. Our number of users increasing. It was around 2,500, 3,000. Now it's around 13,000, 14,000. It's not big numbers, I know, but at least we have a robust infrastructure now that we can add new features on. We can apply new requirements easily. Throughput is a little bit more interesting than the number of users. Although the number of users increased 5 times, the distinct users started to watch more movies, more videos, sorry, more videos. So our throughput increased around 50 times. We can now promote a video with push notification integrations. If there is a funny, interesting movie, we can easily send it to all our users, like 300,000 in total, without any crash, so the throughput gets increased. Few more things left. This is another case. This is my second project with Spring Boot and Spring Data stuff. It's an Android application where we provide a backend solution to the Android client for auto-configuring the APKs, the applications on the Android device, like installing an application, removing it, updating it accordingly. This is a page where we configure what to do, which application to remove or install on which device, implemented in angular.js. All the RESTful services are provided by Spring web REST controllers to angular.js. We didn't use timelive, something like that. And we used Spring Security here to protect our administrative consoles. But I had to find a solution for ruling what to do, for deciding what to do, which commands to send to which devices. I investigated a couple of rule-based engines, but they were amazingly heavyweight. It wasn't very easy to even start with, to begin with. Then I came up with Spring Expression Language. Spring Framework made me another surprise, a good surprise. Spring Expression Language was exactly what I was looking for. What we do now, we just specify the expressions, like in the first line, operation equals to comment, manufacturer equals to Turkcell, blah, blah, whatever the rule is, whatever the expression is. And on the left-hand side, you see a JSON request that's coming from all the individual devices to our backend. The backend just compares, executes the expression against the data, the context data coming from devices. If it finds a match, it returns proper comment set to the device. So Spring Expression Language saved our lives. My last slide. Our new projects, starting projects, are all beautiful from these projects on, because we tried, we liked it, we benefited it, so why not using in the new projects? Everything is using Spring Boot now, based on Spring Boot. Currently, we are working on a big project. It's been a month now that we started, and end of the year, we are planning to put it in production. We are expecting 1 million users and 2 petabytes of storage capacity to manage. It's a big one compared to the others. And we have implemented a mobile analytics platform, collecting events from our mobile applications, like entering an application, opening an application, logging in, moving between the pages, and it makes around 90 million transactions per day, currently processed now. And this, there was a number of sessions diagram, you remember? That's the output of this mobile analytics platform. That's how we collect, how we know how many users do we have and what they do. What we use heavily, mainly, Spring Boot, Spring Framework, of course. Nothing would be, none of us would be here if there were no Spring Framework. Spring Security, stateful, stateless. If one of our servers crashes, our users can keep running through other servers. Spring Data is one of my favorites. Spring Integration, RESTful and web services. And we will be using Spring Social when I go back to Turkey. We need it, we will need it. Thanks for listening to me. And I would like to say special thanks to Spring teams, Spring guys. They really make our lives easier, our customers' lives easier. And see you in the Q&A panel session.
It's great to be here, joining this panel with Tim and Erdem. My name is Zach Lendon. That's my social handle as well. You can find me on Twitter and LinkedIn and all the other social frameworks that are across the land. I'm an independent consultant. I work for my own company, Lendon Creative. I've worked for a number of large and small companies over the years. And I've actually used the Spring Framework for about 10 years. I've actually used it back in the Interface 21 days. So I'm an old school, old timer, even though I don't have many gray hairs yet. So that must mean it's not too bad. I've also used Groovy and Grails for the last 4 years, and so I'm a really big fan of that technology as well. And I'm becoming an advocate of Spring Boot as well. And my talk's a little bit different. It wasn't kind of jumping in. I kind of want to take you through the journey that my client went through. And so I actually work for a very large hotel chain. It's an international hotel chain, and I would tell you the name if it wasn't being recorded and I didn't have legal to deal with. So I will just leave it at that. But we kind of went through this journey to Spring Boot, and it's kind of helping save our enterprise brownfield. And when I use the word brownfield, I think you see some talks where people are using Spring Boot to kind of start with new applications, or they're starting a new infrastructure, and they're not trying to integrate it with existing apps. And so our situation is a little bit different, where we kind of have some bigger modules and bigger applications, where we're integrating Spring Boot into it. And I want to talk through some of the technical and the non-technical things that we've been through in that journey. Because as you've seen, we have limited time here, I'm not going to be able to go too in-depth with code. And plus, there's lots of great Spring Boot talks and examples here, so there's no reason to kind of repeat what you may have already heard this week. So I have put up on my GitHub repo, it's pretty easy to find, again, that handle, and obviously this conference name. Please feel free to start with there, reach out to me, ask me questions, ask me for examples, ask me to look at your examples. The main reason I'm here is to help not just kind of tell this story about kind of how you can use these technologies in non-ideal situations, but it's also kind of contribute to the community. The community has given me a lot. The Spring community has given me a lot. So this is an opportunity to give back, and I'm appreciative for that opportunity. I kind of am surprised that every Spring Boot talk doesn't have a Starbucks man quote. I kind of think it should. He's kind of one of the most passionate developers and talented developers I know, and he gives some great talks if you've seen him here. He also has some talks online where he talks about Spring Boot, and I definitely recommend checking them out. But one of his quotes kind of applies in our situation, and that's kind of what I want to start things off with. He said, any application of sufficient complexity eventually sprouts a REST API. And that fits to a T what I've seen in my current client, enterprise, big company, and I think probably a lot of you have seen in your companies as well. So kind of our situation in a nutshell is we had a very large Spring framework application. It was used basically for all hotel type functionality you do, from looking up information about the hotel to booking and finding your member information. And that worked really well for a lot of years. That was actually in the mid-2000s where that application was started up on the Spring framework and has integrated other Spring technologies along the way. But some things have happened in the last couple years, right? So I don't know if you guys saw yesterday the Apple Apple Watch keynote. They showed Starwood hotels where you can now going to be able to check into your room with your watch. Starwood's also has a Google Glass app where you can actually see information with that. I don't work for Starwood's, but I'm just mentioning these as examples. But you're starting to see where these large web applications aren't meeting the business needs. And that's kind of what, companies, a lot of times enterprises they don't see these things, even though we all see them. But it's those type of things that happen in the marketplace that drive, we got to start building our applications a little bit differently. And that's kind of where this RESTful API came for us. So even when business figures out that they have to start changing how we're building applications, that doesn't mean the constraints kind of fall away. We have this large legacy database, or large legacy code base, that we have built out that does some non-ideal things, some things that we as developers might not like, but we have to deal with sometimes. There's XML wired. We have components and do some auto configuration and things like that. But there's this configuration mess, this dependency mess that is spread out through all the technology, as the technologies have changed for Spring. But doesn't mean all this old stuff gets refactored. It just means that you have a mix of all that stuff, right? So we're dealing with that a little bit. We're dealing with, you hear talks about Spring REST, Grails REST. There's a lot of great REST technologies that you can use. So it can be a semi-valid question of, well, why use JAX-RS? Well, that's the situation we're in for a number of reasons. The technical reason, which has some validity, is we already had existing JAX-B definitions for our mappings for our XML web services, and we wanted to reuse them. We had custom marshallers for taking that data in and out of XML and some validators around it. So it did make sense in some ways to use JAX-RS, and it was actually pretty easy to do, but kind of talk about how that rolled into Spring Boot here shortly. So not just from the technical side, you also have some team things and some architecture things you needed to deal with. You have a wide variety of skill sets. Your whole team aren't going to be senior level developers who are going to conferences and really kind of trying to be on the cutting edge of these things. There's going to be people rolling in and off, and you need to have a technology stack that really fits that kind of changing infrastructure and different operating systems and stuff really well. And any changes you really make in an enterprise setting, you're going to have a very difficult time in a lot of companies. If your company, you can just drop in and say, I'm going to use Spring Boot this week, and I'm going to start using Angular and on these big main projects of companies, you have a really probably unique situation. Because a lot of companies, these things take time, and you have to go at it a very small way. And I think Spring Boot really fits in that infrastructure well, and I'll talk about that here shortly. So we talked about some of the constraints. Some of the architectural goals we have are kind of not surprising that a lot of you would have as well, using best-of-breed solutions, dealing with present-day DevOps. You see Netflix OSS and some of the great things they're doing. We're not there in an enterprise situation. I don't know if we're ever necessarily going to be there, but we're trying to move towards a more modular architecture, towards a more microservice-based architecture. But it takes longer than maybe it should. It's just the reality we deal with. So having a core technology that helps for that kind of migration path is appealing from an architecture side. And then we have some other goals that are kind of just regular software architecture goals. We want to simplify as we add more code. Components and technologies into our stack, we want to try to reduce lines of code, reduce the complexity of the application. We want to increase test coverage. All those things are secondary goals, but they're still pretty darn important. So I want to talk through kind of this journey and some of the technologies we've done through it and the pros and cons and some things we've seen. Some of these are some of the core technologies we've been leveraging or at least been tested out, and we'll kind of talk about where we are and aren't leveraging them. I talked about kind of my groovy evangelism. We had a Maven system. I saw Venkat talk about you don't use Maven, Maven uses you, and I think that's kind of why, one of the reasons why we're switching to Gradle. It's a bit more of a build flexibility. We had an old testing infrastructure, and while it would work, there's just so many recent developments, and Spock is a really great framework in the Groovy space. And so if you're not using Groovy in your technology stack, Gradle and Spock are a great introduction to start kind of doing that. Those are really the gateway drugs to the Groovy stack. So inside of the building and testing, kind of the actual, I talked about the API side of it. We're using Jersey. We talked about the JAX-RS requirement. Jersey's the default JAX-RS implementation. Obviously, we had a lot of Spring components, so Spring is going to be in there as well. I mentioned there's in the slide there about wanting some ancillary services, some of the metrics and logging, some of the other things you would want to build around APIs. We have a desire to have that as well, but we want to have best of breed solutions. We don't want to really reinvent the wheel. And so that's kind of where this DropWizard came in. DropWizard has been kind of the popular microservice framework, and you actually see a lot of things that you see in Spring Boot are kind of inspired, I would say. I don't want to say copied, but they're at least inspired from DropWizard. And then I kind of want to talk about how that kind of rolled into Spring Boot. So let's first talk about Spring and Jersey. It's actually pretty simple to build these web services. People have been doing this for a number of years. There's a lot of good resources online. And it's basically you have a Jersey component that you're configuring. You're saying these are my resources, these are the providers and filters, and some different things that you can do in a Jersey ecosystem. So you're kind of configuring that in a class. You can configure a Jersey servlet. It can sit alongside other servlets. We actually have it sitting alongside other servlets. You can configure it in a configuration class, so in code, or you can do it in a web.xml file. And then you're actually just building your JAX-RS resources. So when you're using Spring and Jersey, you can have bean dependencies. You can use a JSR 330 and do inject, or you can have components in AutoWire. A lot of different flexibility about how you can get access to those components that I talked about that you've been leveraging maybe for a number of years. So what's good and bad about this, and what are some of the kind of the technical thoughts around it? So one of the things we find is that because you have these legacy components, and I talked about kind of these custom marshallers and stuff, you'll start to find that when you're using maybe Jersey around it, that it's not the outputted XML or I guess in Jersey's example, the JSON, it's not going to look quite like you want it to, so you're going to have to override it, use some of their settings, maybe write some of your own custom ones. And so you're really going to write this custom Jersey object mapper. And you can see some examples online. Those are pretty actually easy to write, that's kind of where you go when things aren't quite matching what you would want. One of the things we found is Spring and Jersey are, again, best of breed solutions, and so that's really appealing to us. They're pretty simple. They kind of work well together. They've been tested out. There's a lot of good documentation about it. They're friendly for those development teams that you can say, we're using JAX-RS and Spring, and you're going to be able to get developers to get up to speed pretty quickly with it. But there are some things that fall through for us. It's not an opinionated stack. If you want these ancillary services I mentioned, they're not there. If you want to move to a more modular and microservice architecture, it's war only. So there's some things there that kind of left us a little wanting. And that's kind of where DropWizard and Spring came in. I kind of mentioned that for back earlier when we were working on this project, that was back when Spring Boot was pre-1.0. And so there's a little bit of leeriness about maybe we should be looking into something that's a bit more seasoned in the marketplace that more places are using in production. And DropWizard was appealing, but there wasn't a lot of DropWizard integrations with Spring. You'll see a lot, DropWizard is intended to be very lightweight, and so it's not really intended to be help you from this monolithic to this microservice path. There's DropWizard really kind of operates in the microservice, and it doesn't operate anywhere between the monolith and the microservice. It's just kind of in that microservice. So this project kind of bridged that gap, this DropWizard Spring project. Health Market Science wrote it. Some of the nice things about it, so you can annotate your Jersey resources with the Spring component, and they will automatically get recognized by the stuff in the framework code. You can define your DropWizard components. I mentioned before kind of defining them in a class. There's kind of this already YAML-based configuration in this project, so where you can define your providers and your resources and where your Spring components, like your XML files. There's kind of that, it fits that, it's a nice, elegant syntax around that you can look at. And then it's pretty easy, again, to kind of override into your custom stuff as well. So their Spring Service class is the one where you can, that's where they're marrying Spring with DropWizard and kind of keeping those contexts in sync. And so you can see that marrying logic and change the behavior, add your own. And I think I have an example in that GitHub repo of kind of adding Swagger and stuff in there, some different things you might want to do, you can do in that class. Some thoughts about this project. It uses Maven by default. I kind of mentioned use Gradle. So it actually creates a fat jar. It uses the Maven Shadow plugin right now, use the Gradle Shadow plugin. John Engelman, a colleague of mine in Minneapolis, which is where I'm from, wrote that plugin as a wrapper, and it's a great plugin. I recommend it. There's other plugins that are in the Groovy ecosystem that you can use with this project. The Swagger JAX-RS one's a good one for creating your Swagger components, and Swagger's a API documentation tool. So some of the pros and cons and some of the things that kind of left us a little wanting again. DropWizard Spring, again, is a jar-only deployment, at least out of the box. You can customize and probably do your own things to make it war, but you know we're trying to kind of use best-of-breed solutions, and I think also that best-of-breed solution kind of thing was even the DropWizard's kind of proven in a production environment, you're still using a custom solution from a company that most of you probably haven't heard of. I know I hadn't heard of them before. And so big companies are going to be a bit leery of, you know, they want these best-of-breed solutions they can kind of trust. And so with that jar-only deployment not really supporting our migration path, that was kind of a concern for us as well. So then we kind of got to Spring Boot. Was reading more and more about it. Kind of didn't see it didn't have Jersey support. And I think when I was actually talking to the Spring guys, it was only a matter of a day or two. They're like, oh, you can do it with Jersey. And Dave Sire wrote he created a project where the module is there, that the parent POM, and you can import it into your project, or you can obviously import it with your Gradle as well. So there's a few niceties in it. You can obviously roll your own and do this integration on yourself. But there's some auto configuration in the Spring Boot Jersey project where you can if you annotate your Jersey config file, it'll actually do some of the setup for you and do some of that wiring. So again, some of that auto configuration magic is nice and in there. I talked about kind of some of these ancillary API services that we were looking to get. Spring Boot Actuator has those for metrics and logging, and you can write your own. And there's obviously like 20 or so in there that are already there that kind of give you the pattern of writing your own. So, but out of the box ones are great as well. So that kind of gets you going on those ancillary APIs, and they keep adding them. There's so much progress in the project that's pretty encouraging for us. And then you can kind of start. So we've done the Jersey, then you do the actuator. You can start picking off other pieces of your configuration that might be messy. AOP is one of those things that's kind of messy for us, the Aspect J, the old school stuff. So this AOP auto configuration can be a bit of a savior for that mess. We actually had this situation where we're kind of always running our, I won't tell you what we're deploying our WARs to in production, but it's one of those ugly app servers, but we were always kind of running our applications locally with Tomcat, kind of doing an embeddable servlet, and so you can kind of get that out of the box. We don't have to do some of that configuration we're doing. And it's also very Groovy and Spock friendly, and I kind of mentioned that. I think that you know, if you look at the Spring Boot documentation, you're just kind of not using one of the Spring annotations. You take that off and you just extend specification, and then you're kind of in that Spock testing stack, and that's very appealing as well. So some technical thoughts and some pros and cons around Spring Boot for us. You know, it fits that best of breed desire that I mentioned. Spring and Jersey, and then we're using kind of for these ancillary services, for these foundational services for application, Spring Boot. So even though it's a little bit of a newer project, it's from a known entity that you're not company. Your company is going to be, if at this point they aren't sold on Spring, they aren't going to be sold on Spring. It's very tried and true, and there's a lot of, as you can tell, momentum behind this technology, and it's a bit of an easier sell. It fits that timeline I kind of mentioned, or the migration timeline I mentioned from WARs to jar files. So that's very appealing as well. So if right now you can't deploy as jar files, you can deploy it as WAR files. It's just a pretty easy switch. So it kind of nice, as you're trying to move towards a more modular microservice, it kind of fits that as well. And it's not really an intrusive technology, I think, is nice, is you can use it as little or as much as you want. So you've heard some guys here that are using it pretty extensively, and you can do that. But I encourage you on your project just to add a thing. Like for us, it's just, you know, add actuator or pick off your AOP. Just kind of pick off things at a time. And so that fits that gradual kind of migration path that you're trying to do at enterprises. So kind of in conclusion for us, I think there's, you know, there's a lot of options for creating RESTful services. There's a lot of options for trying to wrangle configuration and environment and all those type of things. And I think Spring Boot's really pretty compelling. I would say that it's not, you know, it's not just a greenfield solution. And you don't have to like start up a new app. You can just with some minor configuration in this kind of week type thing, in this small time frame, you can start using it and then just kind of gradually increase it. So you don't have to feel like, oh, I want to use this technology and I got to try to, how am I going to use all these things? Well, just add the Spring Boot parent and start with that. For things that aren't there that you need to, you'll need to create your own custom things, and that's the nice thing is there's so many components there already that you're going to be able to kind of figure out patterns around that, and you're going to be able to have some type of repeatable architecture at your foundation that you can leverage on not just one project but multiple projects as well. So I think we kind of hope that it'll slowly kind of migrate to other projects and across our company. So again, my suggestions, microservices Spring Boot talk tomorrow, kind of talked about the groovy side of it and kind of mixing that in with your Spring Boot in the microservice architecture. I've seen Marco's talk, it's actually online if you want to cheat and see it early from another conference, but it's a really good one, I recommend that. And I again recommend trying to play with it and try to just see if you can get it, can you get it into your application? Like how few lines of code can you get this into your application? I bet you could probably slide it in at least at some of your companies and people wouldn't even know, because it can really be as small of initial footprint as you want, and then you can just kind of add on as you go on, and I think that's very appealing for brownfield projects. So that's all I have. Thank you guys for coming. So I think our plan, and I'm going to switch off my mic here in a second and go to these. We want to engage you guys and have discussion, kind of, you know, there's a lot of Spring Boot talks that are talking to you. Ask a couple things, ask us questions that we can maybe help with concerns you have or questions you want to know about kind of these real world type scenarios. That's the way we can have, you know, a dialogue here. And so I think that's our goal. We have to switch our mics. And then I'll hopefully get these on.
Any questions out there? Oh boy.
Awesome.
He's gonna moderate.
Yeah. Does this work? All right. So I'm gonna moderate, and but if you speak up, then I won't have to run around the room. Go ahead.
So my first question is if you used Spring Boot in a production environment, as in a cluster where you have multiple instances of an application with Spring Boot running in production, and then did you encounter any challenges? What was your experience with that if you did do that?
The question is if we deploy our Spring Boot application in a cluster in production. Yes, we do. It is quite scalable. It's deployed as a plain old war project in production, and that our application runs on virtual machines on a VMware stack. Depending on the capacity need, we just increase or decrease the number of virtual machines, just deploy it within a few hours, and we get the capacity. No problems at all. The Spring Security, just I can add this part. Spring Security provides stateless session management using the pre-authenticated authentication token stuff. If you use that one, you can easily serve your customers' requests from any instance. Will not be an issue. Definitely. It's very simple. All you have to do is just Spring Web Servlet Initializer class with one line of code in it. All you have to do this, and then you change the Maven packaging type from jar to var. By default, it's jar. You make it var, and it will get triggered.
So, and just one note about that is that if you're doing the embedded jar approach, you're going to be customizing your Tomcat config, you know, in the container customizer. Otherwise, you know, if you're deploying your war to kind of well-known servers, those are pre-configured with the right connectors and all that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, at larger companies, we're typically deploying a war to well-known entities as we try to get away from them over time. So that's the scenario we're working on, is that they've kind of, the configuration's already there, but we just kind of deliver the war file through our semi-old-school DevOps processes. So I'll repeat the question, and I'll let you guys. So as I understand it, so he's asking, as we kind of move to these more jar file type deployments, if the debugging around the application is proving to be more difficult.
And also, there's more and more magic happening behind the scenes, I think is what you're also alluding to. So from my perspective, initially, it was hard. In the early days, as I mentioned, where I was kind of debugging through the framework to kind of figure out what it was doing. I think now that the documentation's published, the examples are kind of clear on what's going on and why, you can kind of back off that. You don't need to know at a certain point. And it's been very stable for very long now. So.
But there's a debug flag, and it's pretty informative as far as if you, like, what's going on. It's pretty clear.
Just one more addition. On your local environment, while you are working, developing on your software, you don't need any extra container. You just start your application server, Tomcat, as a Java application. You say run as Java application or debug as Java application. So it's just one click, and then you start debugging. So it's even easier, faster.
I think there is.
Actually.
I think it is 3.0. I think it's 3.0. I mentioned that yesterday in the boot for the web, that 3.0 is a constraint.
For API stuff, we're not using it, but yeah.
I think it's on that slide, though, 2.5 is important in the product.
Oh, it is.
Okay. This question was, Zach. So, in this tool you're working on, you have to deploy the for production, but you said, if I understood correctly, you're saying you're working on an embedded Tomcat on
Jetty. You can use Jetty as well. We're actually using Jetty, but yeah.
Oh, okay. Because I was wondering, I've gone through the Spring guide about how to convert Spring Boot out to produce people, but I know you can use profiles, produce a jar, or dev instances versus warm or non-dev instances.
Yeah, so I've done that trick in Maven with profiles. So depending on whether I'm in dev or prod, you can kind of switch war to jar. That's one trick. Or just run as a jar in your, you know, Eclipse or IntelliJ or whatever you're using, but then use Maven to generate the war file.
And the nice thing is in Gradle, you can have tasks that can say, you know, you call it whatever you want to do it the way you want to do it, which is one of the reasons why I was recommending that.
You can also change your bean configuration using profiles as well. I mean, like data source on your local. You just define a local data source through Spring Boot data source capabilities, but on your test or on your production environments, if you want to use Tomcat's connection pool, you can just change Java configuration.
The gentleman in darker blue down here.
Yeah. Focused on JBoss and Java, you've got to have all kinds of talents that now has to
I'm going to recap for those who couldn't hear and for the video. The quick one were, and then I'm suddenly forgot. So it was the engineering skill sets. Yes, your team and kind of how your team dynamics change when you go to a more microservice architecture from a more monolithic at large companies. And then the second question was around the scalability of kind of when you switch to this jar type thing and what you're seeing.
I'll just mention one thing about the developer dynamic and the changes. I mean, we were starting greenfield, but one thing that actually kind of gave me encouragement was that once we had that initial kind of the stack, we have a layered stack with Spring Boot. We had mobile developers, JavaScript developers, all going, you know, basically becoming full stack engineers, you know, going right through the stack. And part of it was because they didn't need to do that much to kind of get something to work end to end. But that's in a greenfield thing. But nonetheless, I mean, it's not like you have to really relearn that much. It's if the patterns are in place, you know, it all comes together.
Yeah, I would just say from my experience, I think, you know, one of the complaints we had in the monolithic one, it was hard for people to come on and understand. And so, you know, from an API perspective, we're able to say the people who are building those kind of core services that the APIs are leveraging, the API developers don't necessarily have to know all the business functionality details in it. And that's sometimes where things get caught up. And so the actual testing of the business logic can be a different task that doesn't even have to happen in that API layer. So this kind of splitting up doing API stuff actually really kind of works well with Spring Boot as far as kind of helping you in that dividing things up process. And I think it's also nice for the team members coming on because it's not a big technology shift for them. They're still using technologies that they're familiar with, and I think that helps. And I think, you know, to some degree, they enjoy using newer things as well. So it fits a nice niche in that area. So this gentleman, Mike, asked the same question that I get asked from our DevOps people, basically, which is if we don't deploy this WAR file to our application servers, our favorite ones, and we start doing these jar files, you know, what that means kind of to the DevOps landscape and what kind of things you've had to change in that space, if that's a fair recap.
So we're looking at actually doing just that. So right now we're deploying to our favorite app servers. And considering moving to the jar-based deployment. So there's our ops teams have tools like Salt and Chef and you know, other types of automation tools to deploy and essentially deploy to a master, and then it replicates things to all the nodes. Rundeck. I mean, there's lots of tooling out there that you can use. If you use Actuator, one of the nice things about Actuator running inside your jar is that there's actually a shutdown hook command. You can actually invoke shutdown, and it'll do a graceful shutdown of your jar. I haven't done it yet, but I can see the recipe kind of in front of me, so we'll blog about it later.
There you go. Well, and I would add one thing, you know, at larger companies, odds are they're deploying those WAR to multiple servers already, so they have some type of processes in place. So in some ways, if you can get rid of the app server side of it, which, you know, is asleep at night, service contracts, a lot of those type of reasons they're using it, not for the technology. You know, I think it's more just a letter change to them because the scripts are going to kind of work similarly. They're going to function as a Java application, whether it's a bundled as a WAR or a jar.
Are you referring to something like WebSphere where you can kind of deploy to one master and it kind of replicates? Yes, so some app servers actually have that built in, but yeah, I think we'll evolve.
So question about when you're deploying a lot of jars and the ports on those, how that kind of configuration works?
With Spring Boot, it will automatically configure your application with the default values, but you can always overwrite them. You can change the port numbers, and you can change other things as well. So all you need to do is just define the port number, different port number in your application properties file. Will it answer your question?
Yeah, if you're on the same VM or whatever, otherwise you'd have to have multiple VMs or containers for that. But if as long as you've got some kind of router or Apache in front of you to kind of do the mapping of port to machine, you can do it.
So the question is changes from developing locally with an embedded embedded servlet in a jar file versus then going to production in a WAR file, and what kind of that is meant to your process that you, and changes you need.
The dependencies, for example, if we use Elasticsearch or MongoDB, they are just URLs, IP addresses, port numbers change from development to production. The only main change I had to deal with was the data source. On my local, I just use H2DB, embedded H2DB, but on test and production environments, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. On the other environments, we need to connect to a remote Oracle database whose connection pool managed by Tomcat. All I have to do is just define the profile and arrange the Java config accordingly. You know, if you define any beans in Java config, you can say at bean, blah, 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 public, the bean type and the method name. Just before the method name, you can say add profile, and you say test or production. Then you can configure data source. That's the only thing I faced so far.
Yeah, but my local environment has an embedded Tomcat server jar file, whereas my production environment
is just doesn't matter. But you exclude it. You exclude it. It's all. You can exclude in your Maven or Gradle build script. You have to exclude it.
Yeah, so not even if you don't exclude it, some app servers will actually reject the jar, the Tomcat jar, the embedded jar. So if you actually put the embedded Tomcat jar in your WAR file by accident, Tomcat will actually just say, ignoring the jar. It'll just it sees it and it goes, whoa, this shouldn't be here. So either exclude it in your build process, and it's not that hard. You can just say provided, scope provided in your Maven, or you can actually just say, look, remove the jars at the end of the build.
The gentleman by the door has been very patient, so please. So the question is around when you have a lot of these jar files out there and you have updates to dependencies in them, whether it's for the Spring Boot defined or whether you're manually defining them, kind of how you're getting notified of them and how you're finding out about them and how you're kind of updating all your deployed services.
Well, I can't say that I have a process so much as that one of the things that they're working on, not only through the boot starter POM parents and dependency trees, but through Spring IO, where they're kind of like creating a bomb, which is going to make that even more simple. If the community finds an issue, they're going, I mean, that now that we're all depending on this stuff, it kind of, I'm assuming that that's going to circle back. I mean, they're trying to curate a set of known good dependencies. And so if one of them goes bad and we're all relying on it, it's kind of up to us to kind of notify the world that it's bad. And so I don't think there's a process that we follow necessarily, but I'm assuming that because we're all in this together now, to some degree, it makes sense for us to help each other on that side. So that's what I expect is going to happen. Maybe Spring has a viewpoint on that, but that's what I'm expecting.
I think this is one of the highlights of all these Spring Boot parent dependency things. They also state, Spring guys also state that the developer does not need to find the correct version or mix it up, you know. So.
No. That automation you would have to do yourself, but you could easily, in your POM, override the dependency for Hibernate that and basically override the one that boot kind of gives you by default. So you could, and then you'd have to use whatever automation you have to kind of get out to your instances. But so you're not precluded from doing that, but yeah, you'd have to know about it.
And they're pretty good. You've seen that Spring Boot kind of aggressively releases things. So if there's issues in there, like you should really do this upgrade, they let you know. So I think monitoring those releases. And I think another thing I didn't mention as well is they're very good. Like I monitor Stack Overflow, kind of read what people post, and the core guys are very quick to respond to that. So you know, I think there's a few common channels that you can kind of monitor. And if there's something alarming, there's no good automated way, maybe that's something that's an opportunity, but I think that you can monitor a few channels right now and find out about the true things that are truly critical. So the gentleman has a question, right? You can see why when you're starting a new application, why Spring Boot can be compelling. But if you kind of have this existing application and it's working fine for you, why switch it up? What's the Spring Boot advantages and what we've experienced?
Well, it doesn't work with me. I had a legacy, as I said, as I told you. I had to take the responsibility of a legacy application, but it wasn't easy to deal with. So I had to rewrite. But there, I think the main constraint should be like if you want to impact your clients or not, if you want to generate impacts. It worked well with me. I didn't need to do any impacts on the clients, so it was only on the backend. I switched one box and I turned the other one on. So it depends, I think, also the complexity of the legacy thing that you have. I think it will be dependent on that.
I haven't done this, but I've looked at code that needs this done too. And you know, there's probably no right recipe to do it or why, but you know, I've looked at projects where you know you literally have hundreds of Spring XML configuration files, hundreds, and people are afraid to touch them. People don't know, and they're all in different directories, and it's really hard to kind of know what's going on. And I think Boot gives you this opportunity to kind of simplify and rationalize a lot of that stuff, so that it gives the developers a little bit more confidence. Again, I haven't done it, but it's one of those, just getting rid of those XML files to me is like step one to the sanity that you could kind of bring. And that's like Zach said, you can just kind of do it incrementally. You can just kind of say, hey guys, hey, I've got this branch where I've taken out all the XML files and everything's auto-configured now. You know, it'd be scary, but you could kind of test it and see if it works and then kind of go to the next step. But I don't have a...
Well, I would say just one more thing. I think that, you know, the areas that Spring Boot is addressing, one of the reasons it's appealing to me is this is the areas that a lot of developers are complaining about. The developers aren't complaining about Spring MVC or Spring Data or some of these other technologies. They're pretty tried and proven, and they're working well. They're complaining about this configuration, the dependencies, you know, getting up and creating things more quickly, adding new features. And so, you know, I think with your legacy applications, if you have all these XML files or you can't understand how your dependencies are all kind of wired together and you can't do these upgrades because everything's a mess and you're scared to touch things, you know, you can keep doing that and keep hating life, I don't know, but or you can just kind of start and try this out and see if you can start kind of easing the pain a little bit.
And just, you know, as I noted in the one of the last slides I had was around testability, and one of the reasons it's hard to get a test going when you have, you know, when you don't know what's what in the system and how things get wired up, having just that auto configure and just seeing the system kind of come alive when you, you know, get your Spring context going, it goes a long way to making things more, you know, testable. And if that's one of the ways I would sell it, I would get everything auto-configured and I'd write a couple tests and just show there's no fear now. You can actually do this because I've seen systems that are so complex people don't know how to test them.
Anyone else? Gentlemen. Just asking a question about your static resources, your JavaScript, your JSPs, your server-side templates, and when you change them, whether you have to restart. I think I know the answer, but I've not done it, so I'm going to...
My team leverages a tool called JRebel, which kind of helps you with that. It monitors changes and does the refresh for you. I think there's a bunch of other tools as well that will do that.
If it is Java code, Spring Loaded, I use, it helps to reload the classes and remap all your RESTful mappings. But if it is JavaScript or like Angular.js we use, we don't need to do anything. While deploying, it will automatically detect Spring Boot, will automatically detect the changes. When you click F5 on your client, it will be there. Nothing to do. For Java part, controllers, services, repositories, Spring Loaded is fine.
So the question was whether you can use these web resources in your Spring Boot and not kind of have to change the way you're doing it.
Yeah, no, it's, you know, as Josh Long says, I think I saw a tweet, you know, if you have to use JSP, you need to quit your job. And if you still use JSP, you need to. But yeah, it's supported. It's supported. It's not endorsed, but it's supported. We do SAS. We do all this stuff. You can put on. You have your file watchers for your different tooling. You know, IntelliJ helps with that for us. You're not precluded from using the existing web.
It's still Spring ultimately. Yeah. So all the things you can do.
Yeah. Remember. So I forgot to mention this before, but one of the things is boot is not new Spring. It's, you're using the core Spring framework, data, all that stuff. That doesn't change. And that's one of the reasons, you know, I was comfortable kind of going along with this because it didn't change all that stuff that's well known and tested and solid. It's just a way to kind of make it cohesive and make it easier to use together.
Totally agree. So what about boot made it easier to go to?
It's actually not. So you're right. You could absolutely do this without boot. You could just go to. But it's the auto configure on top of all the annotation based configuration that just kind of makes it all come together.
And I think it is there available as of Spring Framework 3.0. I think. Before boot.
I think some of it for me was you do some things in your application. You think, why does my framework not understand what I'm doing? Like, everybody does this. And I think that's kind of one of those things where Spring Boot can come in there and be like, I know, I understand. I can see you in your class path. I see what you're trying to do. And if you let me, I'll help you. Anyone else?
So we're still, I wouldn't call it a microservice. We're still kind of an app stack. But I can tell you between services, I mean, we rely on a lot of different services internally. We do have a pattern of correlation IDs as we, you know, in headers as we go back and forth. We have a common logging, system. That's kind of it. I mean, it's basic architectural patterns. I am interested. I haven't gone down the road of the microservice. I'm tempted. But right now we don't really need it. I don't know. If you have any.
Well, I think that's part of the reason why it's hard at companies to jump into the microservice thing, because you have things to figure out. Some of this stuff is the easier stuff. It's, you know, the DevOps questions that you have, these type of questions. You know, we're all trying. We all have legacy DevOps, and we have to kind of figure out how we're going to try to do things in this new world, and it's not just the software side of it. So I don't think, maybe Netflix thinks they know all the answers, but I think they're still learning too. But we definitely are still learning them as well. And I think that's why Spring Boot's nice to kind of migrate you through that path as you do that.
All right, thanks everybody.
Thank you guys, we appreciate it.